You may remember a little while ago we presented this little tsuba, this Soten Tsuba, in one of our episodes of What's on the Bench, prior to me doing much needed restoration work on the piece. Here it is now, all the work has been carried out. I want to talk about just a little bit about what I've done and why, but also I think there's quite a lot to say about the style of tsuba, where they fitted into the history of Japan. I think it provides an interesting story. And the signature, which is quite extensive, both on the front and back, lots of curious writing, which to the uninitiated might seem a little bit daunting. But in fact, once you have a few clues or signposts, you can make your way around these kind of signatures relatively easily. So I want to talk about that also. So the first thing to note is the inscription on the sepadai, the area where the handle would sit. This is the name of the maker, the artist, Mogarashi NyuDo. So Mogarashi, the she character here, this third character, indicates that this is an art name, a fanciful art name. So that's the name of the maker, or his trade name, his art name. And NyuDo is a Buddhist title, often taken by lay priests or retired artists or scholars who've retired from normal commerce and the normal world, the regular world, and become more contemplative. And so he's indicating by this that he's in his later years and has attained the lofty ideals of a retired priest. What's worth noting in this present condition is that all of the rust that was on the sepadai and that was encrusting the inscription has now been removed, and the pattern has been restored it's my best guess as to what these patina would have looked like when they were new, based on examples I've had the opportunity to examine in museums in Japan and in private collections. They do seem to have had a very dark, almost black, hematite-type patina, and that's what I've aimed for. The steel is now perfectly stable. Traces of rust have been removed, so everything, all the carving, the detail in the iron itself is nice and crisp. So all these little details, the trees, the inscriptions themselves are nice and sharp and clear. And you can really get a sense of the actual calligraphy that the artist has chiseled over. So there we have his art name and the Buddhist title he's taken on board. On this side, we have Soten Sei. Soten, of course, is the group. Nowadays, we tend to refer to schools of tsuba makers. It's not really necessarily exactly as we understand the term school, as in painting in the Renaissance, say, in Europe, but rather a grouping. In this particular case, the Soten group does seem to be a very well-organized cooperative, in a sense. And so we have Soten Sei. This character Sei denotes made by or manufacture. So literally, that's a brand label. So it's a bit like your Louis Vuitton or whatever. So that is alluding to the school grouping. And on the back, we have further information. Here we have Go Shu. This character, Shu, is a character that denotes province or prefecture. And Go Shu was the nickname of the old province of Omi. Omi Province is the present-day Shiga Prefecture in central Japan, where we find Lake Biwa, the largest inland lake in Japan. So Go Shu, present-day Shiga Prefecture. And here we have Hikone Ju. Hikone, of course, the town, the sort of merchant town that was developing at the time. Ju means living at or resident of. So we know it was in Goshu Province or Omi Province, as it was known back then in the Edo period, and in Hikone. So all of these details fit with what we know about this group. And now I'm going to show you on a map, a map of Japan at the start of the 18th century, when this was probably made, or certainly in the 18th century when it was made, where this literally fits in geographically and historically. This is a map, or a reproduction of a map, of Japan at the time of the unification of the islands under Tokugawa Ieyasu. So this is at the start of the 17th century. And here we have Tokyo, then known as Edo, the new capital for the Tokugawa shogunate. And over here, we have the old capital of Kyoto. And there were five main roads to unify the central part of Japan. To travel on these roads, you need to have a pass. You had to have official permission to travel on them. And every so often, there were official border passes to pass through. So all the movement and trade and travel was strictly controlled. There were two main routes, and I'll point them out here. So on this enlarged section of the map, we can see the two main routes. We've got the famous Tokaido in red. To means eastern, kai means sea, so the eastern sea route, which as you can see, skirts the coast from Edo, Tokyo, present-day Tokyo. This is the Bay of Tokyo here. So you're coming along the coast along here, and then heading inland to Owari, and then eventually to Kyoto. And then you've got the Naka Sendo. Naka means middle, sen, mountain. And Naka Sendo, so the middle mountain, or the inland route. You're heading in here from Edo, heading inland, coming across. This is about 500 kilometers, this route, and down past Lake Biwa. This is Lake Biwa, and Hikone is around here somewhere, and Kyoto is just a little further. Just incidentally, here we have Sekigahara. Sekigahara, of course, was the site of the great battle, the final denouement of the Tokugawa forces and the opposition. This is where Tokugawa Ieyasu had his final victory, and everyone decided that he was going to be top dog, and the Tokugawa shogunate was established thereafter. So that was where the great battle took place there. But the interesting thing and the relevant point about this road, this Naka Sendo, is this was a really important trade route. So all trade between Kyoto, the old cultural capital, and the new capital would either go through the sea route or the inland route. Lords that had to be in attendance on the court in Edo in the sunken kotai system, they had to almost be held hostage at great expense to themselves, one way of keeping the lords in order. They would have to travel along these roads, and passing through Hikone, they would buy gifts for superiors and friends and people with whom they wanted to curry favor in the capital. And one of those gifts, of course, was the Soten Tsuba. They became hugely popular. The subject matter, either warrior scenes from the Genpei Wars, the wars of the 14th century, or Chinese scholars and literary references. These subjects and these particular tsuba were massively popular and were bought in great numbers with official entourages of people and parties traveling from Kyoto or anywhere to the south, heading to the capital. So passing along this route, this tsuba would have traveled along, and that's how those little iron tsuba with the little Lilliputian samurai found their way around the kingdom of Japan at the start of the 17th century. Turning to the Tsuba once more, I'd like to talk about what I've done and why. The first and perhaps most important aspect of the conservation and restoration of this piece was the condition of the iron. Now, if we look carefully here, we'll see that this is quite a soft, almost velvety iron finish. I'm particularly happy with the result here. My first concern was that all traces of active and loose rust, red rust, were removed. There were areas, of course, also where the Tsuba had been worn and bright metal was visible, and things were scuffed and the patina wasn't very even, which led to just a confusion in terms of the overall aesthetic effect. So I removed all trace of the red rust. This is a very delicate job. I don't intend to go into the technical aspects of how I did it, because this is not a DIY lesson on how to fix Tsuba. I shudder at what I might unleash if I were to do that. So as you can see, all loose red rust has been removed. The patina has been re-established where necessary, and we now have a uniform, stable, hematite-based black rust, which has then been neutralized. I actually used tannin in the form of tea, old tea bags, Yorkshire Gold, if anyone's interested, and boiled it. This both neutralizes any residue of any chemicals I may or may not have used in developing the patina again, and it also helps to convert any traces of what may otherwise be active rust into a stable black form. And then the final treatment would be to wax it. I didn't do anything else. I didn't smoke it or do anything like that, or use urushi or anything, because these little pieces are very delicately carved and they really are all about the iron, and they're quite crisp and the overall feeling is quite filigree-like. So it really is important to have everything nice and clean. I mean, you can see these leaves here, they're quite finely rendered. The little pine needles, while they are a sort of a shorthand, just a few chops here and there, they are nevertheless very crisp and clean, as are these stylized clouds up here. That's really important from my perspective in terms of restoring the piece to what it would have looked like when new. Similarly, the textures in the armor, on the shoes, for example, the mail on the, so there, the sleeves of this fellow's armor, all of that now becomes nice and crisp and clear. And we can appreciate the carving and the skill of the makers of these tourist pieces. So that's the iron, and so we have a nice uniform canvas. Thankfully, the corrosion that was there was relatively mild. So relatively small amount of loss to the gold, particularly on the scene itself. The rim has been quite heavily worn, but we can imagine what this looked like new. This rim would have been effectively a solid gold band, so it really would have been quite a showstopper. It's a little bit more muted now. We seem to appreciate that mellowness. But the composition itself hasn't suffered much at all, so it's in pretty good condition. The silver was quite dark in places. Of naturally, silver will develop sulfides and go black. I've left them polished now. Two things happen when silver tarnishes. If the tarnish gets relatively thick, the sulfide that's developing, silver sulfide, is just like a rust, really. The sulfides in the air combine with the surface silver to make a new compound, which we then have to remove. But in the formation of that silver sulfide, it leaves the surface of the silver slightly matte, in some cases very coarse. So these faces had to get a very, very delicate polish. I used charcoal, a very fine charcoal, just to bring the metal smooth again, and then I burnished the material so they've got that glossiness that they would have had when new. I've not tarnished these at all artificially to tone them down, because that will happen quick enough. Within the next 6 weeks to 6 months, this silver will mellow very readily. So there's no need to force the issue right now. And at least at this moment, we get a chance, a little glimpse of what it may have looked like when it was new. The copper, I think I said in the initial introduction of this piece, that trying to retain this patina here on this little fellow, this hero character, who seems to be wanting to stop these rogues, this color was really beautiful, and it's very hard to get a good, deep, rich mahogany, reddy brown on copper when it's on iron, because patinating in the presence of iron is a very different thing to patinating a soft metal piece where you can immerse it in rock shaw. This is a very different process. So to get these colors is very difficult. So this was really, this figure in particular was something that gave me some headaches. But I'm really happy to be able to point out how nicely he stands out now, with the background nice and clean, and these gold leaves nice and detailed. The copper on these pine needles is showing up nicely, as is the sekigane in the nakagawana here. It's a nice color to it. It doesn't have that brash, garish, unpolished, rubbed copper look. So all in all, I'm very happy with how this has turned out. I don't suppose we could have hoped for a better result. Just going back to the rust on the iron, one of the reasons for myself, in terms of conservation, that I think and would say it's very, very important to be really thorough in eliminating any red rust, is that if you were, for example, to have tiny traces of red rust in these nooks and crannies in the details, which can easily be hidden with wax and so forth, those little areas of hidden rust are still active. And even if they're sealed and don't have oxygen getting to them, there are bacteria, in fact, in iron that can produce rust. And so the thing can eat away, unbeknownst to us or undetected, for years. So complex little pieces like this, which are made of, let's be honest here, not the greatest iron. I mean, it's adequate for the job, but it's not the most perfectly refined material. So any rust left in crevices and so forth could, over time, really cause some serious problems. So my feeling is, if you are restoring and conserving a piece like this, it needs to be done properly, and hopefully only once in 100 years. I want to bring you in here now to have a closer look at the little faces. Of course, it's the faces that enliven these kinds of pieces. And what we have to remember is that these were made not as great art masterpieces, but as sort of relatively generic and producing great numbers, tourist pieces in a sense, almost like souvenirs. And so the faces, you know, they're quite characterful. And the nice thing about this example is the faces haven't been badly damaged. And so it gives us the opportunity to have a look, like this little fellow, for example. He really does have a little furrowed brow. His little eyes are squinting. But if you look at it very carefully, it's a very simple carving. There's nothing overly subtle about it, but it's adequate for the scale of the figure. Similarly, the hand over here, you can see his finger, his hand bunched up, his thumb over his index fingers, he's pointing. It's a very simplified, cartoon-like way of rendering figures. As I say, adequate for the job, but you know, there's no mistaking, this is not some artistic or sculptural masterpiece. This face is fairly quickly done,
imagine, the maker had done hundreds of these and was pretty adept and could just knock one out in 15 minutes. And there's the irony, to repair one of these probably takes half a day. This little face, similarly, not much expression, but adequate. This fellow down here, he's what I would call the hero figure. He's not wearing a helmet, bald pate, and a little bit more character to his face. There's some rounding of the cheeks, the nose, the eyes, and so forth. The hand is a little bit more expressive. There's a nice curve to the thumb and the palm of the thumb here. So you get the feeling that the more care has been taken with this character, which again makes me feel that this figure is more significant. I don't know the exact story or episode in the Genpei Wars that this alludes to, but perhaps somebody who's more versed in these stories than me could enlighten us. This little guy up here, pulling his armor on. Again, a little bit more expression in this face than this one. A little bit more care. You might even wonder whether or not there were different artists involved or different carvers involved in doing the different faces. We know absolutely nothing about the actual production methods and processes, or even the arrangement and organization of the workshops and how they related to one another and so forth. It's all a bit of a mystery lost in time. All we have are these little miniature samurai who remain mute, but nevertheless charming.
This should last quite a while now, once it gets to its owner, and hopefully they will be happy with the result. Back is a little less busy than the front. We can see the iron patina quality perhaps a little better here. There's a subtle velvety gloss to the iron. The gold isn't too bright. It doesn't stand out over much. And again, the signature, or place name, the province and the town of Hikone, nicely inscribed. All in all, a really decent example of a fairly classic Soten Tsuba of the, I would say, perhaps early to mid 18th century of its type, a very pleasing example.